Hi! In today's video, I'm going to cover how you can do proper layering by adding holes to your embroidery designs using Hatch Embroidery 3. This question came from a viewer from one of my previous videos, and I'm really grateful for that because it helps me direct content to what best works for you guys. So what exactly is layering when we're talking about digitizing embroidery files? Basically, it's taking several colors or layers of stitches and just putting them on top of each other, just like you would for a cake. The problem is when you do this, it can cause a lot of density in that area, extra pull, and it becomes super thick and hard for it to stitch through. And that's why using holes is so important, because when you want to start building on layers and to use multiple colors on a surface area that you're embroidering on, you need to minimize all of that density and the number of stitches you're going to be slamming into that fabric. Doesn't matter how much stabilizer you have, if you're putting 4 or 5 different layers of embroidery in one spot, that's just not going to work for you. There's 2 very important things you need to know in order to layer appropriately. I did mention holes. I'm going to show holes. That's probably one of the better things that you can do. The other thing that you can do is to change your stitch angle and have the 2 layers basically stitching in opposite directions of each other. So if we pop right into Hatch Embroidery 3, you can see that I've prepared the scene with a circle, and the circle is simply a fill area with a tatami pattern. If we want to make this basically look like a smiley face, we're going to need to put some eyeballs in there. And the way that we could do this is we could just layer the eyes in place and have the direction or the stitch angle for each be in opposite directions. So here's how you can do that. What you're going to do first is you're going to select your item using the select tool. So we go here, we do select. The default hotkey for that is O on your keyboard. Then you're going to click reshape. The default keyboard command for that is H. Now, when you enter reshape mode, you're going to see these orange-ish looking squares with a line. That's going to define your angle. It defaults to a certain point. Everybody's default set up differently. For me, my default right now appears to be 144. Now, if I want to change the stitch angle, I just need to grab one of the squares and realign it, swing it around, whatever works. But bear in mind that changing the stitch angle is also changing how this thing looks. If you notice over here to the right, you can see that it kind of divides the pattern up. And a lot of that also has to do with how it's being filled. Specifically for me, you can see that I start at the bottom of the circle and stop at the top of the circle. And if you don't know how that's going to play out, you can use the player to see. But essentially what it's going to do is it's going to stitch starting up to the bottom until it meets such a point that it needs to switch over. And it will then move its way up and stitch its way back down. So that line that you see right here where the design sort of looks like it's going to get funky, that is actually where those 2 sections are going to meet. So if you're changing the angle around and you don't like that, and this is just like a fringe thing to cover, you can take the start and stops and kind of move them into a position that you feel is going to cause a lot less of that to happen. Mind you, what I just did, moving it over to the same side as the start section, is not going to work for the angle that I've selected. So what angle would work? Well, if we want to take our start and our stop points and put them down at the bottom, you're like, clearly that doesn't look right. And if you notice, it's exactly where my angle is. We move this up and we go to angle 0. Ta-da! Suddenly it looks awesome. So you may have to maneuver both the angle and where your start and stop points are going to be located. All right, now we're gonna stick with this angle and we need to put the second layer in there. So how are we gonna do that? How are we gonna put a layer in for the 2 eyeballs? Well, we're just going to plop it on top. So we're going to select the circle oval tool, and I'm just going to hit the enter key on my keyboard, because if I maneuver anything else around, it's going to look weird. And you'll notice that it's kind of shifted, and now we see like this weird line in the middle again. Just leave it there for now. What's going on is the machine, or basically the application, is trying to optimize the stitching for you automatically in the background. You may want to wait until you're done placing things before you start finagling with angles and such, but it's good to show you all of this ahead of time anyway. So we have this one circle. I'm going to select the select tool so that I can move it, because obviously I put it in the literal worst location for an eyeball. And then I'm going to change its thread color. So there's one. And then I will right click, I will duplicate, and I will move it over. And let's just make it real funny and put it down like this, because it's October. Let's go with a crazy zombie face. Okay, now we can kind of go back and adjust our angles. We know that we wanted to stick to angle zero, and we do have that. But if you hit the reshape tool or press H, you'll see it moved my stop way up there. Why? And again, like I said, it's just to try to optimize your stitching. So I don't really give a hoot and nanny about that, so I'm going to move it back down. And now I can click on each of the eyeballs if I want. I will go to my select tool and I will select an eyeball. If I like at this point, I can change the direction. The angle right now is pretty much going slightly opposite of anything that we're getting with the layer underneath. The point being is that when the needle is going to be colliding and pounding through the fabric and stabilizer of whatever you're stitching to, it's not going to be going over the exact same thread path as the other stitches. If I really want to get extreme about it, I will click reshape, and I am going to change this to a 90 degree angle, which is the absolute polar opposite of the zero that we were doing before. And of course, I can move my start and stops, but it's such a small area, it doesn't really need to do any kind of like auto split. Now, of course, we're gonna do select, grab the other design as well, and do reshape and set it with the exact same parameters. Now, if you're wondering in the back of your head, well, why didn't you adjust one and then copy and paste it? That's because it would probably go through and automatically change the start and stops again, and I kind of just don't want to deal with that all over again. Now comes the pupils. And something that I like to do with the pupils, and why this kind of violates my I like to stay around two layers thick only rule, is because I actually use satin stitches for those. So I will grab a circle tool, and I will put an eyeball in. I'm pressing enter because I don't want to deal with the angles or any of that. I just press enter and I do my thing. Then I'm going to do select. I'm going to change the thread to black. And I'm going to go up here to the stitch type and set it to satin. Now, right now, it's the exact same stitch angle as the eyeball. So we don't really want to have that. Again, trying very hard not to have that kind of thing happen, because it's going to create more density in the area. Now, a satin stitch is going to be going back and forth, and it's not going to have as much going on underneath as a tatami fill, such as the other two layers. So it's not really, you know, like all hands on deck emergency. We can go to the reshape tool, and we can change that angle. You can make it the same angle as the tatami underneath it. You could make it 45 degrees. Either way, it's really going to be fine, especially if you pay attention to what your underlay is. And by underlay, I mean if you go to the stitching section, I hide my camera so I don't block all of this, and you choose if you want to have an edge run or a zigzag. I tend to avoid doing the edge run on some of these extra layers because at this point, that's when you're going to have your pull compensation come into play, and it's entirely possible you may lose registration. So I tend to, at least when I go up a few layers with something like a satin stitch, I only do a zigzag. Now I'm going to take my select tool, and I have the iris pupil eyeball thing selected. I'm going to right click on that, and I'm going to select duplicate. Then I'm going to grab that and I'm going to put it over here. I'm just going to make him wall-eyed. I don't think it matters. I still think he looks pretty fantastic. We're not going to give him a mouth because there's no point in going that deep into a tutorial on holes. Speaking of which, let's talk about the holes. Let's say you don't want to do this. Let's say you really want all of the stitch angles to be similar enough that you are concerned about your layers, or you know you're going to be putting this embroidery design on something that could be thin and might not stabilize if you have more than two or even three layers of stitching. So putting in holes is actually not all that difficult. You're going to use your select tool to select the item in question. You can also select the object from the sequence that is just underneath my camera here, if you'd rather do it that way. And underneath the Digitize submenu, you will go down and you will see Digitize Holes. Now, mind you, your object has to be selected. I do find that it helps to turn off True View. So let's turn that off for now. We still have our object selected. We're gonna select Digitize Holes, and it'll look like it's like remove the selection and everything. Bear with me. So we're going to zoom into the area, and we can clearly see the line that will be the edge stitch around the tatami fill of the white of the eyeballs. So I like to cut the holes in such a way that there's still a little bit of overlap between the two layers. And as much as I love pull compensation, you really can get into situations where it doesn't work all the time in the way that you intended. So with that said, I'm going to take my mouse and I'm not going to put it right on the borderline here. I'm going to go a little bit underneath. And I'm going to start plotting my points just on the inside of where that white tatami fill is going to be. And I just hit enter and it'll just close the circle. And you'll be like, okay, well, great. Where's the hole? You have to press enter twice. So once will be to finish, to make that connection. And then the second time will be to commit to every decision you've ever made in your life and put the hole in place. So we're going to hit enter. And bam, there's a hole. Now we're going to do it all over again for the other eyeball. Select the object that you want. And we're going to zoom out and then back in. And then click Digitize Holes. And then put the hole in just inside the second layer. Boop, like that. Enter to commit to closing that hole, and then enter to say, yeah, I want the hole. That wasn't supposed to sound as lewd as it did, but I'm leaving it and I'm leaving this commentary. Now we're going to zoom back out. Look at this crazy looking fool. We're going to turn our True View back on and everything looks good. Sometimes cutting those holes is going to adjust your start and your stop points. At this point, I may have beaten the application into submission so that it doesn't try to auto-generate that for me. So this is looking great, and it'll stitch out nice and clean without having to crank up your pull compensation settings and hope that everything remains overlapped. Now, I do tend to do a little bit of pull compensation. Now, by default, if I were to, oh, that's right, because there's a few things that don't work. I do tend to crank up the pull compensation just a smidge. If I select one of my objects, I can see the pull compensation is under the Object Properties Stitching tab. It's down near the bottom. Well, middle. Why'd I say bottom? Anyway, it's in the middle. And I'm in inches right now. I apologize for people who don't like freedom units. So I actually will crank it up to 0.01 and just provide a touch of pull compensation. Sometimes if you have text with a tight design, it will look really funny if you try to do an all-over pull compensation that's a lot higher than this. So I tend to lean more toward having those layers overlap just a tiny, tiny bit, as opposed to all over or doing all over pull compensation. I hope that this video was able to help you get through your digitizing journey with Hatch Embroidery 3. Please feel free to like and subscribe to the channel and leave comments below or any questions you may have, because clearly you can see that asking me a question is going to absolutely make me want to do a video to help you and others. Bye.